Friendly mode.
Hello everyone and welcome to this week's webinar covering the field of IT service management. I'm Nick Hundozi from PECB, the organizer of this webinar. Today's webinar will be presented by Mr. Mostafa AlShamy, a PECB trainer and partner from Egypt. And the topic he will talk about is SMS implementation based on ISO 20000 and ITIL 2011. So if you have any questions or comments, please submit them throughout the presentation by using the question box and we will answer to them accordingly. Mostafa, you can start the presentation now.
Yeah, thank you, Nick. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our webinar about how to implement an SMS based on ITIL and ISO 20000. And this webinar is about a very good point because I have delivered many training because I am a trainer in EGYBYTE and I'm at the same time the IT service and the training manager in EGYBYTE and Anafisa International in Saudi Arabia. And I have delivered so many training courses in the Arab region, not only Egypt, but in other countries. And I have one question which is repeated all the time from a lot of my delegates. When we try to implement an SMS service management system, shall we use the ISO 20000 alone or ITIL alone or both of them? So we'll cover this point in this webinar. Our agenda will cover what is ITIL and its origins, and we have many perspectives and point of view, and whenever you are with someone technical, he will say something about ITIL, and whenever you are with another ITSM consultant, you will hear different story. So we need to know what is ITIL and its origins from experts, the owner, the new owner of the intellectual property of ITIL. Then we will cover ITIL lifecycle stages, what are the five stages we have, and how can we use them. Then ITIL processes and functions, and what is the difference between a process and a function, and do we have them all in ISO 20000 or not. Then we will talk about ITIL and the ISO 20000, and how can we mix them together. Then how to start implementing an SMS, a service management system, and this is the essence of our webinar. And we will end with how can PECB help us in implementing an ISO IEC 20000. Okay, let's start with what is ITIL and its origin. ITIL, as I guess some of you may know, is the most famous public framework for ITSM in the world now. But first, to talk about ITIL, what is ITIL? What stands for? It's IT Infrastructure Library. It's an British framework. And a framework is a group of best practices. It's not a standard. And we will have a dedicated slide talking about what is the difference between a standard and a framework. Not ITIL and ISO. It's a generic slide about what is a framework and a standard. So for ITIL, it's a British framework for ITSM. It was first released in 1989 by the Cabinet Office, and it was about how to manage IT services, because at this time all companies and governments are using IT heavily and they would like to have best practices to be shared among them. How to learn from others' experience and others' knowledge, how to transfer this knowledge and experience in a standardized way. So we need to have something which is a framework. But at the same time, we need someone to own the intellectual property. So it's controlled knowledge, controlled the framework. So the Cabinet Office, which is a British body, governmental body, has decided to have its first ITIL book published in 1989, and it was about service level management, how to manage service and the levels needed and required from the customer for specific services. Then it covered help desk, and it goes on. It covers continuity, contingency planning, and change management, and it was the first book in 1989. Then in 1990, ITIL expanded. It covers, at this time, problem management, configuration management, and cost management for IT services. Cost management, which is called now and it was released from 2000 to 2004. Then we have the third version, which was released in 2007 till the mid of 2011, which we have an update in this year, which is called, and it's the current one we have now, ITIL 2011. And by the way, ITIL 2011, it's not ITIL version 4, it's ITIL version 3, update 2011, because we have some few updates, changes from 2007, which is version 3, and 2011. So it's not a complete new version. It's the same version, but with some updates. Now it contains 26 processes and 4 functions, covering the 5 life cycle stages of a service, whatever it could be. But it's totally IT service. By the way, I have some people who said we can use ITIL outside of IT, and I agreed with them because it's a very good framework. And what we have, which is called life cycle and the 5 stages, I can say that we can use it in many things outside of the IT field itself. And then at the year 2013, there was a great change in the history of ITIL, because at this year, Cabinet Office has sold 51% of the intellectual property shares to a private company which is called Capita in UK, and they have made a joint venture which is called Axios, and now it's the owner of ITIL and the other best practices like PRINCE2, like managing successful programs, management of portfolio, management of value, and the management of risk. So let's move to the second point, which is ITIL life cycle stages. Are they 5 or 4 stages? Before answering this question, let's see what are the stages themselves. We have 5 stages theoretically, which are services strategy. And by the way, before explaining the 5 stages, we need to use these stages for each service. So these stages are not for the IT department. They are used for each service. So let's start with the first one, which is services strategy, and it's in the core because it continues all the time. It's not at the beginning of a service. No, it continues with us. And in this stage, we have what's called demand management. Who are our customers? What are their needs? Okay, and how are they need it? What are the number of our customers? is this demand enough for us to invest? And this is the portfolio management, which cares about investment. Shall we invest or not in creating a new service? And shall we have it in sourcing way, outsourcing, co-sourcing, multi-sourcing? How can we invest in this service? Shall we do it our service or give it to another one doing it for us? Sorry. And at the same time, we have financial management for IT services, which decide what is the ROI, return on investment, the VOI, value on investment, what is the net present value for the service and investing in this service, and what is the internal rate of return. Shall we invest in this service or not? And by the way, we have three types of service providers, as ITIL said. The three types of service provider are: the first one is type one, which is internal service provider. It's a normal IT department inside a company, an organization, and it only delivers services to this organization employees. It doesn't serve any other people. And the second type, which is type two, and it's called shared service unit. It's an IT department in a group of companies, and it serves more than department, more than company, but in the same group. It's a group of companies. And we have type three, which is external service provider. It's like a lot of companies we have now as a service provider providing their services to external customers in the market, in the market space they are working in. So whatever you are working in, type one, type two, or type three service provider, you can use the five stages, starting from the service strategy, as I have said, and for the financial management, even if you are type one service provider, you still need to calculate your costs and your benefits. Okay, then we have a new process in ITIL 2011, which is business relationship management, to have what is called an account manager for a specific customer, for a specific department, if I'm type one or type two, for a specific customer, whether it's an internal customer or an external customer. So the services strategy is caring about how to think about investing in a specific service. And by the way, it cares about this option not only in the beginning of the service, no, because service strategy will continue with us throughout the life cycle of this service. Then we have the second stage, which is design, service design. And this stage cares about how to design the service from a technical and the management point of view. For technical management of view, how to have our blueprint, the architecture, the components, the dependencies with other infrastructure and technical solutions we have. And in the management perspective, we have what's called processes. How can we design the processes for this service? And how can we measure them and measure how they are effectively and efficiently working? Because we are caring about business, about partners, about customers, about people. So we have many stakeholders, and we need to keep them all happy. In the service design, we will have a lot of processes like the service level management, which cares about how to manage the levels of services and how can we measure levels all the time and provide customers with reports and having a meeting with them every now and then, something like monthly or quarterly, talking about what happened in the last month or quarter and how can we improve this performance. We have availability management, which is about availability and how to create, design, manage, improve the availability of this specific service. We have continuity management, and there is a small difference between availability and continuity. Availability is caring about how to have our service up and running. Continuity is about if we have a disaster, a crisis, what is the minimum number of our customers we should deliver service to them all the time, even in a crisis? And how can we restore the service for the other customers we have? And at the same time, we have information security management, which cares about how to have processes and procedures, about how to use the service securely, about CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability, and at the same time, all the other aspects of security. We also have what's called capacity management, and it cares about what is the capacity you should have to cover all the demand we have measured in the strategy. And by the way, the demand we measure in the strategy is not about a new service and what we will have in the next 4, 5, 6 months. No, it can cover and it goes on with us till the end of the service. So we can have an increasing or decreasing demand after 1 year, after 6 months, after 2 years. So we need to have two processes. One for demand, which measure and increase the demand of customers, and the other one, which is, they are twins, by the way, and the other one, which is capacity management, which builds the capacity for this demand to be enough to cover these needs. We also have service catalog management. We also have supplier management processes. And then we have what is called service design package at the service design stage end. We move to the third stage, which is service transition. And this stage is a very good one because it separates the design stage from the up and running stage, which is the service operation, the fourth stage. In this isolated stage, the service transition, we build, test, and deploy our new service. Of course, securely, without affecting the up and running services in the service operation stage. In this stage, we have many functions like change management, change evaluation, service validation and testing, release and deployment, all the processes which care about how to develop, to build, to deploy, to test a new service. Then we move to the service operation, which is the longest and the biggest stage in which we have our service up and running. And at the same time, now we have the customer with us, which means that we are caring more about not designing, building, testing, deploying. No, we are caring now about customer satisfaction because now customer is having the service up and running and using it, and its business, the business of the organization or the customer is based and is using now this service. So we need to have all the agreed service level agreements, which we have signed in the service design, up and running now in a good level. So we have some processes caring about the problems and incidents we meet every now and then, and maybe daily in some cases and in some companies. So we have incident management, to manage incidents. We have problem management. We have access management, request fulfillment to cover the request scheme from customers. And we have event management so that we can monitor what is going on now. As we can see, we have four stages until now, but we have the fifth and last one. But by the way, it's not the last one. It's the last one in our explanation. But in fact, it starts with the first one. This stage is called continual service improvement. As you can as you can see, it's not service improvement. It's continual service improvement. It's all the time. So it starts with service strategy and going through the design, transition, and operation. So it goes through the life cycle 2-3. So in the service strategy, we need to have the best strategy. We need to measure the demand curve and so on. In the design, we need to have the best design we have, the best processes to help this design to be effectively and efficiently in the future when it's built and delivered. In the transition, we need to have the best build, test, deliver. And in the operation, we need to have the best quality of our budget and how can we spend it. Business relationship management, to have account manager assigned to a specific customer to have a good relationship with him. In the design stage, we have the following processes: design coordination, cares about how to design the service design package, service level management, to negotiate, agree, design, implement, test, measure, report all the levels of this service, capacity management, to cover the demand we have in the strategy, and availability management, IT service continuity management, information security management for this specific service. At the same time, we have the catalog management, which cares about how to describe the service. How can we write it in a customer language, not a technical language, it's a business language. So it describes the service we are building now, and sorry, we are designing now, in a language which the customer can read. It's not a pure technical language. And for the supplier management, how can we choose our supplier? What are the RFP we are writing now about this new service? In the transition, we have transition planning and support, and this is an internal process, cares about this stage. We have change management. We have a lot of changes in design stage, in transition stage, and actually, most of them are in the operational stage. We have change evaluation to evaluate all these changes before making a decision. We have service asset and configuration management, which cares about all our assets and their configuration and how we manage these assets and configuration, because if we don't have proper management for assets and their configuration, we will not be able to have service management, because service management based on knowing what we have and their configuration. We have release and deployment management, and this process cares about how to build and how to deploy a new service and their components, of course. We have service validation and testing, and it cares about testing the new service, and it works in the mid in the mid of release and deployment. So whenever we have a release, we test it. Then if the test result is okay, it's passed, we can move to the deployment. So the release and deployment management process is divided by the service validation and testing, because as we all know, it's a golden rule, which is no one can test or audit his own or her own work. So we need to have some people to release and others to test, and maybe the first people can deploy what they have built. And the last process in the transition stage is knowledge management, and it cares about how to make good decision making about integrating all the processes we have. It's something like a watch, tell you time, but not in this simple way. It integrates all the processes we have, all the sources of information we have, in a manner which will help top management and decision makers to know all the information they need now to make a proper decision. For the operation, we have event management to monitor what we have in this service and its components, incident management to resolve incidents and to restore service as quickly as possible. We have request fulfillment to receive requests from customers and to provide them with access to service, which is related to another process, the last one, which is access management. And at the same time, we have problem management. And what is the difference between incident and problem? It is the difference between symptom and disease. Incident cares about symptoms, what we feel. I don't have access to the internet. The application is not working. I have a problem in the network. People are saying problem all the time. But from ITSM perspective and from ITIL point of view, it's not problem, it's incident. It is a symptom, not the root cause. So we have a process which is a quick speed process, which is an incident management process, to deal with what the users, the customers feel. Okay, and at the same time, we have another, I don't like to say slow process, but it takes a longer time, by the way, which is the problem management. And problem management cares about how to discover and find the root cause for incidents, or interruptions for the reduction in quality and how to solve this or these issues. And for the last stage, which is continued service improvement, we have only one process, which is seven-step improvement process. And it's a very simple process containing seven activities. And by the way, as we have agreed and as I have said before, we can use this process and this stage in the other four stages. So before moving to ITIL functions, we need to have a very simple definition for a process. A process is a managed group of activities. A managed group of activities. This is a process. We have a group of activities which are managed. We have inputs, and these activities are processing these inputs and produce output or outputs. And also for the input, it's input or inputs. And we have governing body governing the activities, and we have resources and capabilities. So what about function? What is function? A function is a managed group of people. It's not activities now. It's people who are doing specific activities. From ITIL point of view, we have four functions, which are service desk, which is a single point of contact for all the users of our services. We have technical management, which cares about the infrastructure, which is mainframe, server management, network management, storage management, database, development and management, directory services, desktop, and as you can see. And we have application management. Application management, it cares about how to develop, test, deploy, and manage and improve all line of business applications, like financial applications, HR applications. What about if we are an airline company? We will have something called ticketing application. What if we are a group of supermarkets, retailer? We will have a point of sale and so on. So application management is about managing all the applications people in our business need. It's about business and line of business. And at the bottom of it all, we have the IT operations management. In the IT operations management, we have two sub-functions. The first one is IT operations control, which cares about all the monitoring and all the job scheduling tasks, something like backup and restore, print and output. And we have another team, which is more important and bigger organization, which is facilities management. It cares about data centers, recovery sites, consolidation, and contracts. And at the same time, we have a recommendation to have what's called SMO. It's like the BMO, but it's not about projects. It's about service management. It's service management office. It cares about how to have people, because as you can see, we have four functions cares about technical aspects. What about the 26 processes we have talking about? Who can measure these processes? So we need to have what is called service management office, and in this office we can have 1, 2, 3 or groups or teams. It's based on the size of the organization and the number of processes it needs, because not every organization needs the 26 processes, by the way. If we're talking about ITIL and ISO 20000, we need to first know what ITIL benefits. As you can see, we can continually improve our business because we have measuring everything. We can support business outcomes because we are customer oriented, enable business change from needs to have service, all the changes came because as we all know that business is ever-changing business, and it has ever-changing business needs, so we need to have change management, and we have two processes handling change in our services. We can manage risk, and we have the risk management, by the way, starting from strategy and design from the beginning of a service. We can optimize customer experience. We have service level management. We have customer relationship management, so we care about customer, and at the same time, show value for money, because we have a dedicated process for financial management, which will tell the top management that IT department, it's not a cost, center, it's a profit center. What analysts say, as Axler said, most CIOs and IT leaders consider ITIL to be the de facto best practice guidance for IT service management, which means that a lot of CIOs worldwide is using ITIL as their basic best practice source. And we have another saying, which is ITIL has the highest adoption rate of the related frameworks used within IT operations, and it's true. We're talking about qualification. In ITIL, we have a lot of trainings, a lot of certifications. We have foundation level, and we have intermediate level, and then we have a higher level, which is ITIL Expert. Whenever you have 21 credits, you will be an ITIL expert. So to have an ITIL expert certificate, you need to attend whether 6 or 7 courses in ITIL covering the life cycle totally, and take 6 or 7 exams and pass them all to be an ITIL expert. So ITIL expert is about taking training courses, accredited training courses, and passing their exams. What about ITIL Master? It's a new certificate which was released in 2011, and it's not about taking courses. It has some specific requirements, like you should be an ITIL expert, and you should have minimum 5 years experience in a strategic level in IT service management, and you will not write a thesis. It's not a thesis. It's not an academic master. So what will you write? You will write work package about your experience, what you have implemented from ITIL stages, processes, functions, procedures, activities. So it's about your experience. You will write what you have achieved with ITIL. It's not a thesis, it's a work package. So basically, if we are talking about the two most famous levels of certification in ITIL, you can have what is called a foundation, which will give you basic understanding of the fundamentals. What is a service? What is a service management? What is a process function? And how can we integrate them together? Learn the global language used in ITSM. Now we have in the Arab region, any company is hiring a new entry-level engineer. It's a prerequisite to have IT Foundation certificate, by the way. Then how to integrate the processes together, because we don't have them separated or isolated islands. Take the first step to become a recognized ITSM professional, because to start this way, you need to take the first certification, which is IT Foundation. Join the global community of millions of ITSM professionals, and yes, they are many millions now, not million. Create a foundation to develop your skills further. By the way, ITIL Foundation, it's not about IT service management. It's about how to speak the IT generic language. So whenever I am saying an incident, you can understand what is an incident. It's not a problem. It's not a change. So it's a basic terminology. So everyone should have this level of knowledge. But if you are going to become an ITIL expert, no, it's a very higher level. It will help you to understanding the business context and values, because now you know all the processes and functions in details and how to integrate and implement them. Strategic change management skills, because it's now it's not about definitions, it's about services, it's about the IT department totally. Superior knowledge of the ITIL framework, because you have read all the publications now. We have 6 publications. These 6 publications are the 5 stages and the foundation publication, which is an introduction about the 5 stages we have. Ability to champion ITSM in the organization. What is champion? To be a change champion, not by implementing ITSM by yourself, but alone. We can do it, and we have it with others. We can help others to build ITSM with us in the organization. And you will be able to demonstrate high level of competence, of course, after passing all these exams. So before going to ISO 20000, let's talk about what is the difference between frameworks and standards. Framework, any framework, is a group of best practices which are totally optional. You can use one. This is a function part of a stage. A standard is a group of requirements which are totally mandatory. Which means if your organization would like to be certified in this specific standard, it should comply and have all the requirements fulfilled, and there will be an audit. In a framework, there is no audit. In a standard, there is an audit. For a framework, we have qualification for individuals. As you have said, for example, in ITIL, we have foundation, we have intermediate level, we have expert, we have master of levels. So we have training and qualification for individuals. For standards, we have the same. For example, in ISO 20000, we have foundation level. We have the implementer and lead implementer. We have the auditor and lead auditor. And we have master too. So we have qualification for individuals. But when we are talking about certification and what is the difference between qualification and certification, qualification is for people, for individuals, a training for people and certification for people. But when we are talking about certification, only certification, it's about organization. So we don't have a company which is certified in ITIL, because frameworks don't provide us with certification for organizations. Only standards provide us with certification for organizations. So we have a lot of companies in each country certified in ISO 20000, in ISO 9000, in ISO 27000, and a lot of standards, as you know. So in standard, we have qualification and certification. In a framework, we have only qualification. And by the way, this slide works well for ITIL and ISO 20000. What is an ISO IEC 20000? IEC, by the way, stands for International Electrotechnical Committee, which means that this standard is for IT and for technical purposes. It's not about quality management system. It's not about environmental management system, disaster recovery management, and so on. It's about IT and its related components. So last release we have, which is ISO 20000, which was released in 2011. And this slide is copied from the document of the standard. It says it's a service management system, SMS standard. It specifies requirements, and as you can see, requirements for the service provider to plan, establish, implement, operate, monitor, review, maintain, and improve an SMS. The requirements include the design, transition, delivery, and improvement of services to fulfill agreed service requirements. It's like the ITIL in the stages, in the way we are thinking about strategy, design, transition. Now it's design, transition, delivery, which is operation. It's the same, but in different words. And don't forget, it's about requirements, not best practices. Okay, who can use ISO 20000? We have six options. The first two options is about organizations who are looking for service providers who can demonstrate high levels of quality. So the first one, they will not be certified in ISO 20000, but they need service providers to provide them with services, and they need to know if these service providers are high quality service providers. So they need certified service providers in ISO 20000. And the option 3, 4, and 5, it's for service providers who need to use the ISO 20000 to be certified, whether to deliver new services, whether to prove that they have quality and high quality standard implemented inside their organization, whether to improve the current services they deliver. And the sixth option, which is an assessor of auditor. It's for people use. If you are an auditor, an implementer, you can use this standard so that it will be your reference. So there is six categories of people and companies and service providers who can use this standard. But for certification, it's only for service providers, organizations. and four qualifications in four people, as we said. What are the contents and requirements of ISO 20000? ISO 20000 has nine contents, as we can read them now. Scope, normative references, terms and definitions, service management system general requirements, design and transition of new or changed services. As you can see, they are very close in terminology to ITIL terminology. Service delivery processes, relationship processes, resolution processes, control processes. Starting from clause number 4 to clause number 9, these are the requirements. So number 1 to number 3, they are explaining what is the purpose of this ISO, who should use, and some definitions. But from 4 to 9, it's about the requirements, all the requirements that you as a service provider should comply with and have conformity in applying them so that you can pass the audit and have the ISO 20000 certification. If we need to have a deeper look at the requirement, as you can see in this diagram, for the service management system, which is clause number 4, it's about management responsibility, top management responsibility, in providing resources and commitment, governance of processes operated by other parties. If you have some of your processes and functions operated by other service providers, how can you prove that you are controlling them? Document management, resource management, establish and improve the SMS. Who are the people responsible for the SMS operation and improvement? If we are going to clause number 5, which is design and transition of new or changed services, we have a general part. We have plan new or changed services. It's about planning new or changed services. And we have another part about design, transition of new or changed services, and the transition of new or changed services. If we move to clause number 6, it's about service delivery processes. We have capacity management, like ITIL. We have service continuity and availability management, like ITIL. But now, they are combined in one point, as one process. But in ITIL, we have them separated, as you know. We have service level management, service reporting, information security management, budgeting and accounting of services, which is called in ITIL, financial management for IT services. And the difference is, in ITIL, financial management for IT services has three parts: budgeting, accounting, and charging, which is optional. So in the ISO, it's only budgeting and accounting. We don't mention the charging bits because it's optional. Then in clause number 7, relationship processes, we have business relationship management. We have it in ITIL. Supplier management, we have it too. In clause number 8, we have incident and request management. Now we have these two processes combined as one in ISO, but in ITIL they are separated: incident management and request fulfillment. Problem management, and the last clause, which is control processes, we have configuration management, change management, and release and deployment management. As we can see, I read that all these processes are from ITIL. So does this mean something for you? Shall we combine ISO 20000 and the ITIL implementation in our project, or what? How to start implementing the SMS we are talking about? We have now two sides of the same coin. On the other, on one hand, we have ISO IEC 20000. On the other hand, we have ITIL. For ISO 20000, it's about what? What requirements you should comply with. In ITIL, we have how to implement them, how to design them, how to improve them. In ISO 20000, it includes only processes. In ITIL, it includes processes and functions, the people who are doing and managing the technicality part, the technical part, and the process management part at the same time. In ISO 20000, we have no maturity levels. We have conformity or non-conformity. We have only two levels, conformity and non-conformity. And in the non-conformity, we have major or minor, but it's non-conformity. In ITIL, we have five levels in what is called BMF, Process Maturity Framework. It measures the maturity of a process from level 1 to level 5, so we can measure and improve them, re-measure again our maturity level. In ISO 20000, we have group of simple requirements. but we don't know how to implement them. Although we have part 2, 2000, sorry, 20002, which describes how to implement 20001, the requirements. But at the same time, ITIL has a lot of information, more than what we have in ISO 20002. It contains detailed process inputs, activities, outputs, interfaces, critical success factors, key performance indicators, and many, many more. In ISO 20000, we have generic training for 3 levels, which are the foundation and the implementer or auditor and their senior, of course. And by the way, senior is not a different course or to have, not senior, the lead level. It's not about a different course or a different exam. It's the same. It depends only on your experience. If you have more experience and you can prove it, you can have the higher level, which is lead auditor and lead implementer. In ITIL, we have many training courses and levels. ISO 20000 is smaller in scope. ITIL is bigger in scope. So what shall we do? Maybe both of them. Yes, actually implementation will need more than what ISO IEC 20000 asks for. And at the same time, we have in the ISO 20000 processes some needs, some people needs, some function needed now. And these functions will need to have a RACI model. RACI model. What is a RACI model? Who is responsible? Who is accountable? Who is consulted? Who is informed? So we need to know all the roles and the responsibilities we have. So my recommendation and my experience in this field says that we can have 7 simple questions, and this will help you how to implement your service management system. The first one is, what is the purpose of the certification project? Is it to have only ISO 20000, or we need to have some specific quality measures in our business, in our company, and maybe the scope and the purpose is bigger than ISO 20000, by the way, and I have seen it in many organizations. Do we have enough support and commitment from top management? If you don't have, don't start the project. If you don't have top management commitment, start the project. What is the question number 2? What is the certification scope? Is it for our data center, our service desk, our IT department in one country, in one continent, or what? What is needed from ITIL? Do we need anything from ITIL? We should know from the start. Shall we do it our service or have a consultation company provide this SMS and building it for us? Do our internal IT department and the involved staff have enough knowledge and experience and not? And if not, we need to develop their knowledge by having training before starting the project. Take care of this point, because we have many failures because the training is delayed. Do we need any accredited training and certification for our team? It should be written. And do we have enough awareness within our organization about quality management systems and their values? Because believe me, it's not about people who are doing the SMS. It's about all the people in our organization. So we need support from all other departments, and we need to have awareness for them. So you can build your plan based on 8 points, simple points, but please take care of them, because every one of them will affect the success of that plan. The first one, top management support is the first step you need to start with. The second one is clear scope will increase the success rate of the project. And as an advice from my side, start with the strongest part in your IT department to take the certification for this part. And then the certification is for 3 years, by the way. And then in the annual audit, you can increase or decrease. And in this case, you will increase the scope. So start with the most important part you are strong in, and then increase the scope after 1 year, after 2 years. Don't forget ITIL guidance and the training. So, if you need training for ITIL or for ISO, don't make it late. Start as early as possible. your scope can be bigger or smaller than ISO 20000. So don't say it's only ISO 20000, because by the way, there is some processes in ISO 20000 needs other processes and functions which are not mentioned in ISO 20000, but are mentioned and explained in details in ITIL and the other frameworks. All of this starts with quick wins, as I have said. Some processes depend on or are built on others. Keep it in mind. Continual service improvement. Start with this point. Whatever we will make, we will continue improve it all the time. Don't ever forget to have a change champion. Try to have as many as you can change champions who are people believing in your project, in your SMS, and the benefits which will be collected at the end of this implementation. And our last point in this webinar is about how can PECB help you. PECB, which is the Professional Evaluation and Certification Board, is a certification body famous worldwide for delivering a lot of certification for people. Because I have said certification and qualification. Here it's called certification, but from our point of view, it's a qualification for people. We don't deliver, or PECB doesn't deliver certification for companies. It delivers training for people. For a lot of ISO standards, as you can see, and PECB has earned a reputation worldwide for integration, value, and best practice by providing this assurance through the evaluation and certification of professional against rigorous internal, internationally recognized competence requirements. By the way, in the Arab region here, PECB is number one in relation to other providers due to the quality of the courseware, the material of the training, and the prices and the maintenance fees, by the way, because it depends when we are talking about a certificate which will remain with you for many years and you need to renew it every now and then. For official training courses, as we can see, we have a lot of ISO standards. Some of them have the IEC section and others don't relate totally to IT. So whenever we have a need, we should check this list. Maybe it's included in PECB offerings. And what gives PECB strengths amongst others and rivals are its accreditation by ANSI. So whenever you are accredited from PECB, you are acknowledged and your certification is recognized worldwide. So whenever you work in an international company or you are traveling to work in another company, another country, another continent, whenever you have a certificate accredited by ANSI from PECB, it's acknowledged from any company in the world. So for the training PECB is providing in ISO 20000, we have the foundation level, which provides you with simple definitions about what is an SMS, what is the contents of an SMS, how can we build an SMS bot in a simple way. And many people should take this training. Even people in an organization working in IT department, although they will not implement the SMS, but they need to understand the components. They need to talk the same language with those who will implement and audit the SMS. A higher level we have, which is a lead implementer and lead auditor. For the lead implementer, it's about the people who will build the service management system themselves. Okay? And it can be for a project manager who will lead the project. It can be for the technical consultant who will do the project. It can be for external consultants, member of the service management team, whoever needs knowledge to implement an ISO 20000 service management system needs a detailed, deep level knowledge and experience, and he can find this only in a lead implementer course. It's 5 days, it has a lot of information, a lot of experience, and a case study, so you can know how to implement SMS after attending this course. At the same time, if you, on the other side, on the auditing side, you need a training course telling you not the contents of ISO 20000, but how to audit an SMS, because it's not written in the ISO 20000 itself. ISO 20000 is saying what are the requirements for an organization to be certified in ISO 20000, but it doesn't speak about how to audit this organization. But this course covers how to audit any organization needs to be certified using ISO 20000 and at the same time ISO 19011, which tells you how to be an auditor. So this course not telling you about ISO 20000, it's about how to audit ISO 20000 organizations. So it's for auditors and the people in the team of audit and external consultants. And by the way, I have some people who combine the two certifications, like myself. Because whenever I'm implementing a service management system, I would like to build it in a way which is how the auditor will audit it in the future. So if you have the post certification, you can apply for ISO 20000 master. If you have passed the lead implementer and the lead auditor and you are certified, you can have the highest level, which is ISO 20000 master from the ECB, and it's a very highly recognized and ranked certificate. It means that you are capable to implement and audit an SMS based on ISO 20000 standard. So please, if any of you have questions, submit them, and I'm sorry for taking all this time, but it was a very great webinar for me, and I hope it was so for you, because we have spoken about a great topic, and it needs a lot of time. So please write your questions, and not to take a lot of time, we can answer them and send them back to you whenever we have a time, today or tomorrow, maximum.
Okay, Mostafa, thanks. Thanks very much for this great presentation. And thanks to all attendees for attending the webinar. We hope you enjoyed the webinar. As Mostafa said, the time is limited, so we received all your questions and we will answer to them by email. So please don't forget also to check our website and our social media channels for more information about our upcoming webinars. Be remembered that every Tuesday at 10 a.m. European time, PECB is going to organize webinars for different topics that are related to IT service management. Thanks once again to all and have a nice day.